right. Good morning, Eastern Heights. We're so glad you're here to worship with us today. Would you please stand as you're able as we begin our service with a passage of Scripture and set our minds and hearts on God's Word. This is the Word of the Lord. Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. For the Lord Most High is awesome, the great King over all the earth. He subdued nations under us, peoples under our feet. He chose our inheritance for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loved. God has ascended amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid the sounding of the trumpets. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing to him a psalm of praise. God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne. The nobles of the nations assemble as the people of the God of Abraham, for the kings of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted. Amen. Crown him with many crowns. Sing together.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but his own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died. Power a scepter sways from pole to pole that wars may cease and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end and round his pierced feet fair flowers of paradise extend their fragrance ever sweet.
Good morning. I don't know if you had an opportunity or not, but in the news section of our building, you will see a large cross that's up there. I'm going to get you to bring up that PowerPoint for me. Silas got in the picture. But you'll see that new cross that's located there in the building. If you take a look at it, I want to give you a little background on this. Back when we were going to be doing the expansion, we put out a bunch of rocks for everybody, and we asked you to take one rock that you would take home and pray to remember about the church, and we touched the other rock for you to write something on and bring it back. And so you were to take one rock and pray, and then you were to bring the other rock back. And so folks brought the rocks back. Some people wrote verses on them. Somebody put their names on them. Some put their pictures. If you look, some attempted to draw pictures of themselves on there. And we got all the rocks back, and we had collected them together. And for a while, if you remember, we kind of had them on display. Then we sent them to Grant and Alyssa Ramsey, and they were working on it, on a way of bringing it all together that would kind of reflect our unity in Christ together as a church. Well, surprise, I didn't even know this. I got the text yesterday from Grant, and he had finished it. We didn't know he was that far along on the process, and it hung it up in our sanctuary. A great verse that we held to that time during the rocks is from 1 Peter 2:5 that says, "You also," talking to all Christians, "like living stones are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." What a great testimony. And so now if you were here when we did that, take time, look in there and see if you can find your rock located there. If you haven't and you joined us since then, we want to let you know, even though you don't have a rock up there, you are a part of what God is doing here. So would you guys join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this visual reminder of our unity in Christ. But also a reminder, Lord, that you are continuing to work and shape us. That none of us are a completed project. And none of us are perfect in all that we do. But that you have never given up on us. That you never quit working on us and never quit shaping us. And that you are building us into what we will be for eternity with you. So, Lord, as we look at this cross, let us be reminded of our unity together. But let us also be reminded that you continue to work in all of us. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you please stand once again as we continue to worship together?
How great thou art.
I shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart?
I shall bow,
then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim. Thou art saved, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. He is worthy of all our praises. Let's continue to sing to Him, to focus on Him, on His character, His goodness, His power, for He reigns over all the earth. And whatever is consuming our hearts and minds, He is greater. Greater is He who is in us than He who is in the world. And God, we ask that You remind us, that You would reconnect us with You. And this is what You have done through the cross. There is a fountain filled with blood.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunge that flood, lose all their guilty stains.
Thank You, Lord. The dying thief.
The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more.
Save.
Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more.
by faith, we saw the street.
Their sins by faith, I saw the street, thy flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die.
In this poor, lisping, stammering tongue,
when this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. Thy power to save, then in a nobler, sweeter song I'll sing my power to save.
Let's pray together. God, we look to you with gratitude because you have provided the most precious gift. And if you did not withhold your own Son, how will you not also with him graciously give us everything that we need? Whatever we think that we need, you are sufficient. Your grace is sufficient. Help us to trust you. Help us to look to you. Help us to find our unity in you. Find our peace in you. Find our strength in you. Lord, as we turn to your word, we pray that it would be planted deep within us, that you would bear fruit in our lives that reflects your glory and your goodness. We pray all this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You may be seated.
This morning, we are going to be returning to our look at the book of James. This sermon, I wrote this sermon before the Christmas break, and I had it all done, and then we went into Christmas, and we did the Christmas sermons. And it's, as we've seen before, a book that was written 2,000 years ago seems to have an incredible application to our lives today. So this was, like I said, written before Christmas, and I was amazed as I was going back into and looking at the application and just the way it speaks to us today, 2,000 years later. So let's get into it. Chapter 4, we left off, and we just finished chapter 3, and we were starting chapter 4. So in chapter 4, verse 1, and he says these words, "What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you?" Now, I want to remind you, James, when he's writing this letter, is writing to Christians, and the way I like to say it is he's telling the Christians how to live out your salvation. Now, he's not telling you how to get saved. He is saying, hey, you're saved, so what should this look like? What should your life look like, and how should it be reflecting that salvation? So a few things we've learned so far. He said, anger does not produce righteousness. So you're never going to produce righteousness through anger. He talked about how a lack of mercy is what causes favoritism. He talks about how the unwholesome language can make your faith seem to others worthless. So our words matter. And he says that an immature faith does not produce goodness. So if you're not maturing your faith, you're not going to produce goodness. And now we see that he picks that up and he says that the cause of fights and quarrels is by this desire that is battling in you. Now you might say, well, Chris, no, that's not true. That's not what causes fights and quarrels. What causes fights and quarrels is the other person is an idiot. That's what causes fights and quarrels. What causes fights and quarrels is someone hurt me. That's what causes it. And that's the way we often see it. But what the scriptures are telling us right here is that the fights and the quarrels, it's not them, it's me. The problem is not them, but the problem is me. Oh, I can already tell you, I don't like this. I don't like where this is going. Because I'd much rather say it's them and have to realize that it's me. So what does James mean? But we're going to go on. We're going to find out what James means here and what the scripture is saying to it. What does he mean by these desires that are battling you? So verse 2 says this. You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and you fight. But you do not have because you do not ask God. Let's take that first part of that just right here. It says, you desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. Now, we took the break from James, but if you can recall going back to chapter 3, when we left off, James talked about that selfish ambition and that bitter anger that we get into our lives. If you guys remember that, if not, I encourage you to go back, read chapter 3, going into 4. We put chapters and verses, okay? That's not how James wrote it. It just comes straight flowing through, but we break it up as we're looking at it. So he talks about that bitterness, that bitterness that leads to anger, and that selfish ambition that's there. So he's picking up on that. He's continuing that discussion. He's returning to those two ideas, and he's talking about that bitter envy is that hatred, and it's that hatred that you have that somebody has something you think you deserve and they don't deserve it. And you get consumed with this anger over this, that they have this and they don't deserve it and I deserve it. And that anger begins to build in you and it manifests itself in sinful behavior. So kind of phrase here, sinful desires lead to sinful behavior. Why do we behave in a sinful way? Because we have these sinful desires. It begins in here. It doesn't begin out there. It begins in here and then manifests itself in this sinful behavior. So we can see this where sin kind of takes stuff and it makes it even worse. Like you take competition in sports, great, it's enjoyable. But when competition gets out of control, it's terrible. It ruins the fun of the game. In sports to go see it or something. Or divorce. Divorce is a terrible thing. But then the divorce turns ugly because it's just a sinful desire starts getting into sinful behavior. And it not only affects the people in the divorce, it affects everybody. All society is hurt by it. Or you take civil rivalries, you know, every brothers and sisters, and they're going to fight with each other, and they're not going to get along, they're going to argue. But when it gets to be ugly, it gets out of hand, and those sinful desires get to the point that you're hating your brother and your sister, oh, some of you know what I'm talking about. It's terrible. It's destructive. Those sinful desires that are in us begin to come out, and then they cause this sinful behavior. We turn on the news and we see somebody and we go, this person killed their kids or killed their spouse or killed their neighbor. And we go, why? Why would somebody do something like that? And we realize the anger just kept growing in them to the point that it just came out in a terrible behavior. And coveting is the same way. We desire something and we can't get. And so when we cover it, we desire it. So we steal it. I want that. It should be mine. I should have it. I'm going to steal it. We often think about this in material possessions, but it's not always that. You can steal someone's intellectual stuff. You can steal their reputation. You can damage their relationships. There's lots of ways of doing this, but you're coveting it. And so you steal it. Now, I hope you realize that anger that... that can lead to the point of killing somebody, then that it begins small, by the way. No one, well, I guess most people, do not wake up and just say, I'm going to go kill somebody. I mean, the anger begins to grow. That anger or that sense of coveting that you're willing to steal stuff from people to have it, that those are not characteristics that should be present in the life of a Christian. I hope we're in agreement on that. Those things should not be there in the life of a Christian. So we got to do something. What is going on here with this problem? Now, I wanted to show that last part of that verse. He says this, which is really insightful. He says, you do not have because you don't ask God. So that selfish ambition is wanting to get something. That covetedness is wanting to get something, but it's not wanting to get it the right and holy way. He says, you're not asking God. Why don't we ask God? What are some reasons for us not asking God? We have these fights, these quarrels in our lives are caused by these desires that are driven by anger and covetedness, and it's one of the reasons is we're not asking God. Well, one of the reasons why we don't ask God is our pride. We want to do it ourselves. We want to say, look at what we accomplished. Self-reliance is a wonderful thing. It's good that we teach our kids self-reliance within limits. We got to understand within its limits of what it can be done and the limits of our skill. But sometimes we overemphasize that. And we so much overemphasize it that we want to do it on our own. We want to accomplish our own. We don't want to ask God for anything. Now, we don't have a problem asking God to bless something. I did it. God bless it. Right? But we still know, in our heart, I'm the one who did it. I'm just asking God to put, you know, a nice coating over it so it looks nice. But that pride, that selfishness that's in there is causing us not to realize our need for God. And when we don't realize our need for God, we become ignorant of who we are, our limitations, and we become ignorant of who God is, his greatness. And so our pride keeps us from asking God. But there's another reason why sometimes we have a problem, and sometimes we're asking, but we're not really asking. The other problem is we ask with sinful motives. And we got the sinful motives. We're not really asking, as the scriptures say to ask, but we're asking with a sinful motiveness. Look at verse 3. See, when you ask, you don't receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. This is an interesting fact here for us. That the motivation is just as important as the act of asking God. We'll emphasize a lot the need to pray. But I don't know if we emphasize how important it is, the motivation for your prayers. We'll talk about, are you praying? Are you talking to God? But what's your motivation for that? What's driving your prayers and you're talking to God? And a lot of this has to do with your willingness to be open to what the Holy Spirit has to reveal about yourself. Again, remember, I said the problem is me, not you. So I was trying to think of an illustration to try to prove this point. And every illustration I came up with stepped on somebody's toes, or I thought it would step on somebody's toes. So I thought, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to step on my toes, and if your toes get stepped on, it's just an indirect, but it's me, okay? So here's the thing. This may come as a shock to some of you. Please brace yourselves. Sheila and I, pastor and pastor wife, occasionally have disagreements. Hold it. Calm down. You might call them quarrels. You might call them fights. Now, you may ask yourself, how can two people who are so incredibly in love with each other have fights? Well, part of the problem is because we love each other. And because I love Sheila and I'm in love with Sheila, I want Sheila to recognize me and give me attention and put her focus on me. And so I desire to get from her attention and her praise. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. I hope that if you're married, that you want that, the attention and praise. But here's the thing. I don't always get all of her attention and praise. And when that happens, I feel rejected. And when I feel rejected, I get angry. And when I get angry, and I let that anger grow in me, we end up having fights that occur. Now, is the problem Sheila, that she doesn't praise me and give me enough attention? Of course it is. It's clearly that's a problem, right? No. The problem is clearly me. If I sat down with any of you here and I said to you, here's what's going on, I would hope in Christian love you'd look at me and say, dude, you're the problem, not her. And those times when I will listen to what the Holy Spirit has to say, often too late in the process, but when I listen to what the Holy Spirit has to say, I suddenly realize that this desire in me is a selfish desire. I am expecting from Sheila something that is completely unrealistic. She cannot continuously be giving me all her attention and constantly praising me, nor is it healthy in our marriage for her to be like that. That would be a terrible marriage if she just goes along and constantly just praising, giving me attention, whatever. I mean, I wouldn't mind trying it for a while, but it would really probably be unhealthy for the marriage. And as I begin to realize that Sheila does love me, and I do see all the ways that she does praise me and all the ways she does encourage me, I begin to realize, as I'm doing that self-examination, I realize the problem is not her, the problem is me. And I realize that the problem is that I am selfish. And I am being selfish. And that what really needs to be going on is I need to be encouraging her to grow in her relationship with God. I need to be praising her and growing in her relationship with God. I don't need to be focusing on me, but I need to be encouraging her that she grows in that relationship with God. And so no longer is it just about feeling good. And by the way, that's not wrong in your marriage to feel good. But that shouldn't be the ultimate goal. That's why a lot of marriages suffer, because they make that the ultimate goal, and it cannot be a realistic goal. But it is that God will use me, that God will use me to encourage her. See, the motivation of my prayers then change. Instead of my prayers being, God, you need to change Sheila's attitude and make her realize how good I am, to God, how can I make my wife grow closer to you? Because here's the incredible thing. The more she grows closer to God, the more she's going to grow closer to me. We may think it works the other way, but the way it really works is the more she's growing in relationship to God, the healthier our marriage is going to be. But only way that that can happen is really by examining my life. Now get this. This works not only in marriage, but it works in the relationship between parents and children. This not only works in marriage, it works in your workplace. What's the motivation? What's the desires? Are you feeling? I mean, the boss comes in, the boss is a jerk, and you feel rejected, and you get angry, and you want to fight. Whoa. You can't change the boss. You'd like to change the boss, but you can't change the boss. But you can't have God deal with you. This happens in our society, in our churches. We have to, it's tough. It's so much easier to point out what's wrong with them. So much harder to look at us. But this is what God's working on, is us. And so we see that work in our motivations. Now you may say, Chris, I'm sorry your marriage is a mess. And I didn't come here to hear your problems. But aren't you blowing this out of proportion? I mean, you're just really kind of just blowing this whole proportion. What's the big deal? If I'm a little selfish, what's the big deal if I have a little bit of sinful desires? What, I mean, you're kind of blowing up. Well, let's see what James thinks. Who cares what I think? Let's see what James thinks. He says, you adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be friends of the world becomes an enemy of God. Now, before I get in that verse, let me define for you two terms here. The first is that word world. When he says that word world, he's not rejecting everything in the world. He's not saying, oh, Christians need to be sad and miserable and pitiful, and you know, if you're smiling, you're probably sinning sort of thing. You're not here to have fun. That's what heaven's for. That's not what he's saying. All right? When he uses that word world, he's talking about sinful things. So he's just putting all the sinful things and using that word world in there. The second word I want to explain to you is that word friendship. And what he means by friendship there is to become familiar with a sin. So we all struggle and we all sin and we all fall short of the glory of God. We all got that. But you shouldn't start being friends with sin. You shouldn't become familiar with that sin. That sin shouldn't be your buddy, you know. So you walk in, they're like, hey, you're back, all right. You know, that's, so you're fighting your sin, but he says, watch out when you start making that sin so familiar that it starts becoming who you are and how you identify and what makes you feel good. So that's what he's talking about there. And he's talking about that. So he says that, he says, you know, don't you know that friendship with the world, friendship, familiarity with sin puts you against God. And then the word he uses here, he uses this term adulterous people. So let's go back to see that. You adulterous people. That's a tough term. Why not just say, you bad people? Are you morons? But he uses this term, adulterous. As a matter of fact, he's taking that from the Old Testament. And throughout the Old Testament, we find when the people of God were in disobedience to God, the term was used, was God used for him, he called them adulterous. Now, adultery is in simple terms, is the breaking of a covenant relationship between two people. That's the definition, but that's nowhere near explaining the intensity of what that word means. We like to use a word, we like to say, they cheated. No, when you're playing Uno, you cheat. This isn't cheating. Adultery destroys society. Even societies that are not Christian, societies that are not based on Judeo-Christian principles, understand that adultery is wrong. They understand because they see the destruction that occurs. There's psychological destructions, there's social impacts on our lives. It destroys homes, it destroys businesses, it destroys our nation, it's destroying our churches. It destroys a person's value and their understanding of trust. So that James would pick a word that when I said would produce in so many of us just a cringe of disgust is intentional. He wants you to understand this is a big deal that even non-believers understand this term as being so disgusting. I hope you understand that he says that when you choose to go with friendship over sin over your friendship with God, it is disgusting. You are choosing not to simply say, I'm just going to indulge in sin. What you're saying is, I will become the enemy of God. That changes the nature of it right there, because I can justify, I don't know about you, but I can justify my sins pretty good. I can come up with, oh, I was excused and I was bored and this and that. But when it gets to, now you're being an enemy of God and it's adulterous? These sinful desires in us are nothing to just kind of pass off and say to ourselves, oh, that guy got so angry he murdered his family, but I would never do that. I'm sure that's what they said. That person got so covenant, they stole something, but I would never steal anything. I'm sure that's what they said. What scares us about it is we are just as likely to do it as them. Except that as believers, we're revealed what the problem is. And they don't. We know that it is this desire that is battling in us. And worst of all, it makes us enemies of God. Is it really worth it? Is that sinful desire, is that really worth it? Is it really letting that grow and build? Is it worth? I'm not even talking about getting along with each other. I'm just talking about your relationship with God. And so verse 5 is our our final verse we're going to look at. And by the way, we're going to come back next week and we're going to talk about the solution. And if this sermon's been uncomfortable, next week's going to be uncomfortable too, because the antidote's pretty hard. But it's worth hearing. And I encourage you this week, go back and just read chapter 4. Read chapter 4, go back, read chapter 3, and go into chapter 4. So we're going to finish on verse 5. Or do you think, the scripture says without reason, that he jealously longs for the spirit he has caused to dwell in us? Now, this is one of the harder verses in James to translate how the word structure should go. We understand the concept of it. We're not exactly sure how to understand the exact word structure. So I'm just going to, in this case, give you the overall concept instead of breaking it down. And that is, the concept here is that God, who's given us life, desires to be in relationship with us. So that word spirit that you find here is not reference to the Holy Spirit. It is a reference to life. You know, he breathes spirit life into us, the spirit in us. And what the concept of this verse is saying to us is that God wants to be in relationship with you. Now let me kind of press this out a little bit more. One of the characteristics of God is that he is creator and sustainer of life. And so everything that exists, God created, and everything that keeps going is because God's holding it together. All right? It's incredible, the science that's all behind it, but at the end, God's holding it together. And this creator, this holy, eternal, all-powerful, all-knowing being who is so far above us that our minds can't even grasp or understand, this being who is up there wants to be in a relationship with what is faulty and unholy and full of problems and issues and battling desires. He wants to be in relationship with us. And that is so mind-boggling that he has to say to us, the scripture says it, because there's no other way to figure it out. It doesn't make any sense in this world that somebody that great would want to be in a relationship with me. We sometimes say, you know, God loves us and wants to be. What? Why? I'm nothing but trouble. I have nothing but problems. If somebody says something bad about me, I'm like, hey, you don't know half of it. And yet God says not only does he want to be in relationship with me, he jealously longs to be in a relationship with me. So as creator, he desires this relationship with his creation. And he desires that with you. And the thought that I would choose to damage that relationship, that somebody this great wants to be in a relationship with me. What? What? Why would I want to damage that? God jealously longs for it. So I hope that you see in these first five verses that James is helping us see that these desires that battle in us, as much as we want to look outwardly and say that the problem is out there and the problem with is that group and the problem is society, and what do you want to say? No! The problem is you. And this is what God's concerned about. It's his people and working with us. And it's a serious deal. And it's not something we can blow off or just push to the side. Because God jealously longs to be in relationship with you. So as we conclude, let me give you five questions. And I hope you'll hear this morning. I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching to me. All right? Trust me, I was hoping there'd be some other Christian holiday today that I could preach on. You know, the only thing after the Magi is a slaughter of the innocent. So it was working well. So I had to go with this and deal with this. So I'm dealing with me on this. So here's four questions for you. Do you want to stop fighting and quarreling? Now I realize there's some people, they're fine with the fighting and the quarreling. It's got to become part of life. It's part of what you do. You like the anger. It makes you feel good. I don't know what to say. If your answer to that is no, I'm fine with it, then I don't know what to say. But if you do want to stop the fighting and the quarreling, if that's really dark, then you can go to the next question, which is, are you willing to see if your desires are sinful? Because if you want to stop it, then you're willing to say, okay, let God examine me and look at me and show me what you see in me. And as you begin to look at that and say, are my desires sinful? Then you come to this question of, okay, so what are my motivations for asking God? What's motivating me in my talking to God? What am I wanting out of this? Is I only wanting stuff that benefits me? Am I wanting stuff that fits my pleasures? Is that my goal in life? Is to how much can you communicate, you know, gain? What is my motivation here? Or is my motivation to glorify God and to serve God and know God's in control and see people come to know Him? And that brings you to the biggest question: what friendship do you value? Is your friendship with sin the one that means the most to you? Or do you look and you say, no. It's my friendship with God. Because He jealously longs for you. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, as we pause here in this part of James, I know well that the next part is going to have to deal with humility. Lord, it is so much easier to point out the problems out there and to pat myself on the back and say, but you're one of the good guys. So much harder to realize that I'm saved by grace, that I never get to the point that I don't need a Savior. It never gets to the point that any of us doesn't need a Savior. That any of us don't need grace. God, I wish to say that I jealously long for you, but my heart wanders. But you never stop jealously longing for me. So, Lord, show us our motives. Reveal our desires. Because we want to be in relationship with you. In the name of your Son who makes that possible, we pray. Amen. We're going to close the time of invitation. With perforated sheets, if there's decisions you'd like to make or folks you'd like to talk to. But more importantly, use this time to talk with God.
Would you please stand as we respond together? Maybe you don't have the words or the prayers or even know where to begin because the battle's too hard. Battles within us. But God is able to change us from the inside out. So let this song be that prayer that we would be changed, that we would be filled with love, with joy, and with true peace. Let us be known by our love. Seated. It's our favorite time. The world famous Gary Pavey, everyone. Gary Pavey bringing the announcements.
World famous. Wow. I didn't know I got that big there, but yeah, appreciate that. Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody had a good week. I do have some announcements for you guys. I've got to read something here for you. Check this out. Great job, Eastern Heights Baptist Church. The North American Mission Board has recognized Eastern Heights as one of the top giving churches in the state of Indiana. Yeah. I thought that was pretty cool. All glory to God. We appreciate you guys, and we appreciate what God's going through this church here, so we appreciate that. So second announcement, we are in the process. I hate to say this, guys. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, we're taking down our Christmas decorations. I know it's bad, but it's time to put them away. We do need your help. If you can help out tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, that'd be awesome. We appreciate it. The next thing is this week, we have Wednesday night Bible study, of course. But, okay, the following week, we will not have Wednesday night Bible study. I'm giving it to you a little bit in advance, so you mark it on your calendars. Plus, we need a little help with this. We're cleaning our carpets during that week, not this week here, but the week after that, okay? And so next Sunday, after 11 o'clock service, you can help us out, kind of clear the classrooms out. Anything that's got carpet underneath, we got to take things off of it so we can get it clean and everything. So if you can help out with that, and then after we get the carpets clean that following Saturday, we are going to put everything back to get ready for our Sunday classes. So I know a lot of information for you, but we have in the bulletin here, so you check those dates out for me. I appreciate that. So the last thing is going to let you know, please check out the awesome display that Chris was talking about earlier this morning about our church, the rocks and everything like that. It's really cool. Grant did a great job and everything like that. So I've always talked about Grant and listen, the great things to do at church, and Grant, all the woodworking does, and he's a masterpiece. And so I always call something like that a Rembrandt masterpiece.
There you go.
Okay. I got the same response at 9 o'clock service. That's the last time I used Google for jokes, okay? So anyway, that's all the...
yeah.
It's all in the introduction, right? So anyway, that's all announcements and jokes I have for you guys, so let's go, Lord, in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this time we got to come here to be with you, Lord, to hear your message, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to give, to spread your glory, to glorify your name, and to let your son Jesus be known, Lord. Lord, we ask that you continue to be with us during these times, this upcoming year, and give us peace and joy, and turn this over to you, Lord. You have it in control. We have that peace. Lord, we thank you for the many, many blessings you give us, church. We thank you for your love that you have for us and love that we have for you and for each other. Watch over us, especially the ones who are sick or dealing with the illness. Keep us safe this week in everything we do. These things we ask your son, Jesus' name. Amen. You guys have a great week. Thank you.